Hello guys, how are you all doing? So excited for this session, really. Welcome back to episode 9 of Get Fit with Utopia, a place where we help you eat smarter and live better. Before I begin with the session, I would like to wish you guys a happy Ganesh Chaturthi. I know in Mumbai the celebrations would have been better, but anyways, it's all good. It is said that everything happens for the good, so let's take it in a positive way. All right. Guys, the adventure of our life is to learn. And to keep our learnings alive, we have today a very vibrant speaker who is a branding specialist, national basketball player, and a state-level swimmer. He's the founder of B Hatke and Vitiligo India and has traveled numerous places around the globe. I can't really wait to invite our speaker of the day, who is none other than Mr. Shivaji Chaudhary to today's live session.
Hi guys, what's up? Hello, Shivaji sir, how are you doing?
Pretty good, pretty good. What's up with you?
All good, all good. I was literally so excited for this session, I was counting time, like when would I have a conversation with a legend, probably.
I see. I mean, I was excited as
Alexa.
well. I mean, it's the weekend after all, so and in my town it's raining heavily. I mean, I know Mumbai has always been filled with showers, but then yeah, it's good to have rains in Rajasthan as well.
Oh wow. So how are things there, considering the COVID situation?
I mean, there have been a few bursts, but I hope everything gets clear. I mean, I think it's everywhere pretty much the same. We can't really do
Right.
anything except do the social distancing and follow all the norms we have. And with that being said, a lot has been hampered with fitness.
Correct. Correct. Can't agree more
Right.
with you, sir. All right,
Yeah.
so your journey has been so dynamic. I mean, right from the state level swimmer to becoming a national level basketball player, and now to a founder of two companies. How did you manage to be the top of the game at every field that you stepped in?
Should I talk about the sports part first?
Yes, sir. Please, please.
I
It's all
mean,
yours.
so my father wanted me to be a national champ swimmer, basically. So I've been swimming since I was competitive swimming, and I think I was very young. In fact, for the first time ever, I went for my state level championship. I was too young, so I was not even allowed to participate. But I was still able to
Okay.
compete with my with seniors, basically.
Right.
But anyway,
Right.
so I did competitive swimming till 14, 15, and that's when I left and did tremendously well. I mean, I could say that I had a couple of medals in the state level as well. But then after that, I shifted to basketball because I thought, I don't know. I mean, I became a little bigger, and then I think I was kind of done with swimming. So I picked up basketball at 16, and then within the first 3 months, I got selected for my first ever national camp.
Oh wow.
Right. Yeah. So I mean, I feel sports is pretty much my life. It's part of my lifestyle, and anything I do, it's all sporty, I would say. Yeah.
Yeah, that's fantastic. And how the imagination came to you to start a company, like two companies. You're a founder of two companies.
So, I mean, more than a company, I would call it a startup venture. And to be honest, if I talk about B Hatke came out of desperation and boredom, because I came back home and I'm like, dude, I should do something, and I think I'm capable of pulling off a few things here and there. So that's how I thought I should figure something out. And so we came up with an apparel brand, and then we shifted from Rajasthan to Delhi, and we tried doing things and collaborated with some celebrities here and there. So I tried to pick a few things, whatever I could do at my end.
Right.
And if I talk about Vitiligo India, that's my cause. I have vitiligo since I was I got it when I was 9. So about it and tell my story, because a lot of people have this and a lot of social taboo attached to it, which I kind of faced
Correct.
in my early days, in my early years. But then at the same point of time, I think I kind of changed my own mindset on how to deal with this. And
Right.
yeah, I think I'm in a better place for myself first.
All right, so since you have talked about like people start to judge, you know, when you have a disease like this, so how do you train your mind? I'm assuming some people who are watching this are already facing through one. So how did you manage to excellence your mind, you know, apart from being judged and stuff like that?
So I just wanted to point out that vitiligo is not a disease, first of all. It's a skin condition.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So right. That's the basic myth people have, like, you know, oh my God, someone has a disease or something like that. It's absolutely not. That's number one. Secondly, how you train your mind is that firstly, it takes a lot of courage. It takes a lot of courage to figure this whole out. Because I keep giving examples of basically somebody has a pimple, right? A pimple is just for 5 days. That will go away. Right. Like, you know it. This is something you probably might live with for your entire life, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you need to accept that this is part of nature and this is absolutely normal, right?
Yeah.
Because for a simple reason, like, if you don't accept it, that you're continuously just talking about it and cribbing about it, why me? I mean, that's another question we usually ask when you have bad things going on. Why does it happen to me only and things like that, right? So, unless you change your mindset about that, like, you know, this has happened and that's okay. It's just that we can make people aware that, dude, this is absolutely normal and this could happen to you as well. Right?
Got it.
So that's the mindset. And then you understand life and people so much through vitiligo. I'm so thankful that I got vitiligo as much as it's like a blessing in disguise. See, you as much as you like it, you also, as much as you dislike it, you like it as well because you understand society, how people judge, how people reflect, and their reactions. So then you can stand from a distance and you feel like, okay, so there's a circus going in life. And then you just actually a spectator and looking at others like, okay, so that's how you guys live. And I was a part of this as well. So, yeah.
Wow, sir, such an inspiration you are. I believe that, you know, the way you have spoken about this issue is really, really, and I think it's pretty normal to have vitiligo. And yeah, it's just like a pimple example that you gave. It heals, you know, at time. Correct. All right.
Yeah. So, I mean, a lot of people go through it. And I mean, vitiligo is just one part. There's so many other things, man. I mean, somebody has a mole, somebody has something else, psoriasis, and there's so many autoimmune problems going on. You can't control everything. And that's absolutely fine, right? Hey, guys, shout out to Mamba Mentality. Yeah, absolutely, guys. Dude, those are my things. People commenting, right?
So, all right. So, moving ahead, yeah, people are so excited to see you, I guess, you know.
I don't think about that, but yeah. All right,
so talking about fitness, when anybody, you know, utters the word fitness, what comes in your mind? Probably it's mental fitness or the physical fitness or say overall fitness.
Oh, man, the first thing comes to my mind when I say fitness is challenge accepted.
Wow.
So when I say fitness, I mean, it is such a part of my life. If I don't do any physical activity in the evening or by the evening, I don't really feel good about myself. And of course, lockdown kind of, you know, screwed up a few things, but then I was doing my home workouts. But that's the whole point. So for me, fitness is not just physical or mental. It's a combination. It's like basically you're training yourself. You train your mind and body together. And the best part is how you balance both. Sometimes you feel tired, but your body, I mean, sometimes you mentally feel tired, but your body is ready to go and vice versa. So you need to have the right balance to go ahead with it. And I love fitness. Yeah.
Wow. So when we talk about fitness, what is the importance of protein that you would like to talk about?
The importance of what?
Importance of protein in your diet.
Yeah, of course. So, you know, a typical scenario when I used to work out, go to the gym, and, you know, there were like myths about, let's say, protein intake and extra the supplements and things like that. And I was like, okay, no, man, I want to go all natural and, you know, let's do this and let's do that. Then a few friends, like, they actually helped me, like, I want to take away this myth from you and figure this out.
Mm-hmm.
So I tried a few things and protein acts, it's such a common sense you need so much of basic knowledge about these things that I was missing out on protein. Like, why didn't I even take it earlier? Like, right. Boiled eggs is right. Such an important thing. Chicken is so important. Your chunks, I mean, your sprouts, or whatever it is. My whole point is nutrition is so important in general. But you have that ego in yourself. No, I can do it without. I can do it with your dal roti. I can do it with my whatever I eat. No, man, you need to have a proper diet to go ahead with this. So yeah, I feel protein is absolutely important. I mean, that goes without saying.
Yes, over. Got it.
And I also want to say that we lack so much of knowledge in nutrition and our diets. When we talk about sports and fitness the most. We lack a lot of knowledge as a country, I would say. So we need to make people aware of these things as well. Like, I wish I was really lanky, like a tall 6'3", skinny dude in college and school. Because I used to have practices all the time. But I wish my diet was better. I wish I could eat those proteins, I could eat those nutrients, or I could have probably have a heavier body helping me to win more games.
Absolutely, and I think it's the learning part which everybody, you know, we have got 2 ears and a mouth for a reason to adopt more and speak accordingly. Great.
True.
So I've also heard that, you know, you kind of boost people with their confidence. You try to help people dealing, you know, who are having low self-esteem or something like that. So if you were to guide the viewers about some of the training programs in confidence, and what is the basic thing when we say confidence that comes in your mind?
Confidence is power. Confidence is something, of course, you have introverts and extroverts and all those different personality types. But if you're talking about confidence right now, you walk into a room. And you have that energy. Mm-hmm. And people feel that energy. That's confidence to me. Like, okay, so there's a gathering happening and somebody walks in and like, yo, what's up? So that's a different kind of energy, right? And the problem is that it's not a competition and that everyone has to be confident or this and that. It's that we can be confident by not showing emotions and feelings also, right? So one should be confident with themselves first. Then should be everything else. Okay. Showing the world is secondary, to be honest. If you're confident with yourself, then you don't really need to show to the world. I mean, people will see you eventually.
Incredible.
Yeah.
Wow.
If you talk about self-esteem in terms of, like, a lot of people, of course, ask me about, because I have vitiligo and I still do all these things. And, I mean, I go by a simple mantra, man. I mean, I just have one life. How can I not enjoy? How can I not do things? How can I not have experiences? How can I not be a part of something I really want to be? How can I not go to the swimming pool? Because I have vitiligo, you can't stop me from wearing shorts. Things like that. Nothing's
correct.
Not happening.
So what importance would you give to self-love in that?
Oh, I love myself. Just kidding. Maybe I'm not, but yeah, so I love myself for sure. You can call me a narcissist person also. I don't have a problem, but again, the same thing with confidence. Like, you need to have confidence in yourself first. In the same way, you got to love yourself first before you spread it out there. So self-love is so important. I mean, again, has a lot to do with acceptance, has a lot to do with challenging yourself. If you think that, you know, you feel you want to do something better for yourself and whatever, in whichever way you want to be, right? So you accept it first that this is where you are, and then you move on. Like, then you proceed. I have family and friends commenting my as well.
So grateful that you took your time out and joined our session.
Yeah, I had asked them to. Always there to support me.
That's so good. Yeah. Family support is needed in all.
Yeah. I've got my cousins as well who play basketball as well, and especially the smaller one, Veer, so he's been on that as well. I saw him.
Oh, wow. Incredible. Yeah. Thank you, Veer, for joining our session.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So since you have traveled like a lot of places, so how, my basic question to you would be, how do you maintain your diet when you used to travel?
Yeah, so when you're traveling, of course, your diet definitely gets screwed up. I won't deny that. But at the same time, the kind of traveling I do, as you're a little aware of what you have to eat, you will find a way to figure that out. Like if I have to have this much protein, or like I need to have a chicken diet for today, like I need to have that kind of meal. So I will pick it up from the market. I will probably go to a restaurant, just eat what I really want to eat. Right. So as much as it's important to travel, I feel like, you know, what you're eating with it is, you know, because you can go a long way. And the kind of trips I used to do, I used to be on backpacking trips, not in fancy five-star hotels. I was probably camping in a jungle. So you got to cook your own meal, and that was so nice. So those kind of experiences, yeah, once in a while you go out there to a restaurant and have your meal and whatever. But then so many times you are anyway on a calculated budget and diet. So you have your boiled eggs, have your porridge or whatever works for you. You have your bananas, yeah, things like that.
Well, good. What traveling has taught you personally?
I started traveling pretty young, and thanks to my grandparents, I think the most important thing what I learned out of it is, like, there is not just one way of living. Not just one way of living life. I mean, as we try to keep telling everyone my way of living life is better, my country, my state, my religion, my caste, and my skin color is better. Bullshit. There are different ways to live. There are different ways to be happy. And you know, that's what it has taught me. Because the way I thought while I was here, or let's say if you're in a city, and then suddenly you go to another country and you see them sitting on by the roadside and they're just still smiling. So I'm like, okay, how is this definition of happy different from mine?
Wow.
So you got to learn and accept that there is another way to live and another way to lead a life that is not just your way to live. So yeah. That's very important. That's why I always tell people, like, learn to accept that there are more things, not just you.
And I think happiness comes from within. Like it is said that, you know, if you have got a human life, it's God's gift to you. If you have got a human life, it's God's gift to you. But if you live your life beautifully, it's your gift to the God.
Yeah, I mean, take it in a little petty manner. You have been given life.
Right.
Can you do anything about it? Yes. Only you can do everything about it. If you give control to others, then it's your fault. So you control your life. So, I mean, my B Hut K collection, there was a t-shirt. I mean, this is it's called Vitiligo t-shirt. I have a t-shirt which said, drive your life. Basically, so you control your own life. If you don't control it, I mean, if you're giving the other person the steering to the drive, you can't blame them. Blame yourself. You got to control your own things.
Got it completely. Thank you for answering that. I think you have talked about acceptance and being happiness, and happiness in the sense comes from within rather than depending on other selves.
True that. I mean, everything has to start from you. You want to be a good basketball player or a swimmer. I mean, not your neighbor is not going to be like, I want to see this person. You got to wake up early, got to train yourself, eat your diet, and, you know, just strive for greatness, man. Always.
So somebody has died truly Hatke and an inspiration for our family.
Pardon me?
So somebody has died truly Hatke and an inspiration for our family.
Yes, I don't know. But yeah. That has kind of worked out.
Got it. So, we are about to conclude this session now. So, sir, I was just wondering if you could add a personality development tip that you have learned, especially from others and observing others, that you could tell our viewers on this episode.
First of all, keep it real. That's one of my things. Like, you gotta, you know, always do things you really like. As much as we get stuck in the societal bullshit, there will be a time in life where you will realize and you will probably step back and reflect onto the things, what has happened in the past, how you have, the kind of person you have become, and how you want to proceed in life. So there are three parts to this, like the past and the present and the future. So you reflect onto how things happened, what you are now, and how you want to go ahead. So we need to take a deep breath and literally be silent for a while, go on a trip, sit on Himalayas, go to a beach, do something. I mean, it can happen just in your own living room also. I'm just, you know.
Right. Right.
But you need to realize, realization and acceptance teaches so much, gratitude teaches us so much, and I wish we all get to that level. So personality has to start from there, because once you're humble, once you have that kind of gratitude attitude, you have that, I'm hungry to learn, in short. And you want to learn because you know there are other people out there, you know there are other people better than you. And you can only learn from them, and you can be better than them, and you can take that as a motivating factor that I want to be better than them, but I want to still learn. You need to learn. And I have learned this from my own family.
Oh.
The most. Right. So I've got like a family full of, you know, people who have done a lot of things, and I'm highly inspired by them because they never stopped learning. Like my grandmother never stopped reading books till she was 60, 65. She never stopped. And a very basic example she gave, 65. I used to say, yeah, that, my grandmother. So she never, she always used to read books. And I was a teenager back then, and then she used to tell me, I used to go and nag like, I'm getting bored. Like, how can you get bored? There's so many books to read. There's so much to learn. How can you get bored?
Oh, wow.
So that kind of thing comes up, and then you learn, and then you figure out what you want to do now, and then how you want to proceed again.
Got it. So, since you've talked about Himalayas, you know, right now, so how important would you give to meditation? Just the last question to you.
Meditation is important. My mother does a lot of meditation and a lot of practices, and she keeps pushing me as well into it. There have been times where I felt divine when I do it. But I wish I could be more regular. I know I'm very, you know, lazy or stubborn on that front sometimes. But there have been moments where I feel like, no man, I got to sit down. So I do my like a good 20-30 minute session at times. And isme Himalaya jaane ki zarurat nahi hoti. But the whole point is like, you know, you can just sit and do it anywhere, right? But of course, like the reason I said Himalayas, or I mean the beach, I mean the natural spaces, is because everything is still. Like nothing moves except the waves and the wind and the trees, right? So nothing moves. So you're just looking at something constantly. There's nothing moving, and it makes you stop your mind for a bit.
Got it.
And you're at peace, and then you're calm, and then you start reflecting, because otherwise in our daily lives we have been moving around at such a fast pace and everything that, you know, you just don't get a chance to do things, man.
Absolutely.
Shout out to Akshay Khichi as well. Friends keep commenting here and there, but there are a lot of my basketball friends here.
Oh wow, so grateful to have you guys here. Thank you. Yes, so thank you, Shivaji sir, for sharing such an invaluable information. I hope it added a value to our viewers who are watching this, and so grateful to you for coming in and sharing your wisdom with us.
Cheers, man. Cheers. And I hope you guys also continue doing... you have done your 9th episode, right? And I hope for the next soon. Sir. Right. And all the best for you guys as well.
Thank you, sir. All the best to B. Hatke and Vitiligo.
I wish I could do more for them.
All right, Thank you, sir.
Cool. Awesome. Cheers. Bye.
Take care, sir. Jai Hind.
Bye.
Alright, so what an incredible session it was. So much to learn from. He talked about acceptance being part of ourselves. You know, we always tend to be in an area called gray area. It's neither white nor black. So we have to find out our space, our things, and then move on accordingly. Thank you so much to the viewers who have joined in, and so very much grateful. We have an amazing speakers lined up. So do follow our page for more updates, and wish you all a happy Ganesh Chaturthi once again. Thank you so much. Until then, eat smarter and live better with Utopia. Thank you.